Okay. You know what? I would like to encourage you to be with us at prayer. I know prayer seems, I'm not trying to lay a guilt trip or anything. Prayer is maybe not as exciting, but you know what? That's our tools of warfare. That's what we need to do. But you know what? The more we pray, the more it becomes a hunger in our heart. So I would just encourage you to come. And let me pray for these young folks as they go to learn. And Miranda Landers, his wife, Alan planted the Calvary Chapel in Austin, years and years ago. And he's no longer at that ministry, but his wife, Miranda, is a wonderful singer, and she was nominated for a Dove Award. So they're gonna lead worship, and he's gonna teach, and I think it'll be just a time of blessing. He's from California, but he came through Albuquerque, and we kind of had a loose association through them when we lived in Albuquerque all those years. But I encourage you to come out for the young women's retreat. I'm sorry. And men, pray, you know what, men, for the retreat, I would like to get partners that will go with me in the back room and pray while the ladies are in here. You know what, we do that on Saturday nights, for the Free Indeed ministry, and you just have no idea what a precedence that sets and how that is so good. I know I'm sounding pray. Well, go figure. I'm a pastor. What would I say? So we need to pray, you guys. And, hey, by the way, do you know, everybody knows who Charles Spurgeon was. And if you don't, you need to get to know who he was. He's called the Prince of Expositors. And do you know what the key to his success was? The Tabernacle in London, England. I can't remember the name of it. But it's a huge facility. It's been there forever. And his success was he always had a group of prayer warriors. And I mean a group, not a couple, but a group of prayer warriors praying in the basement every time they met to teach. Every time. And I mean, and we still use his commentaries today that he was such a great expositor, but let's put credit where credit is due. It comes from those that are willing to get down on their knees. Look, said enough, but I just ask that you would consider joining us, and I think you'll be blessed if you do. Now, one last thing. Gwenda, are we having Thursday morning? Yeah, we're going to cancel Thursday morning because Gwenda's got an appointment with a doctor that you can't hardly get into, and so she's got to go to that. So Thursday morning, and could we get that on the website and all that so that nobody shows up here? We will. Okay, yeah, women, if you want to come, you can come join and pray. It's up to you all. You can gather together afterwards and talk about it. Okay, now let's turn our attention to the Word today. And then we will give introduction and then get into it. Paul starts this way. He says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called, with all lowliness, gentleness, with longsuffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Hey, that's pretty good. He's in y'all. All kidding aside, This is some really powerful things. See, Paul starts in verse 1 here. He says, "Therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which with you were called." You know, it's interesting. Paul calls himself a prisoner of the Lord. In chapter 3, he tells us that he was a prisoner in Rome. But he never refers to himself as a prisoner of the Romans or Rome itself, the city government, the country, the empire is what it really was. But he refers to himself, he was imprisoned, not because they said it, but because of the gospel of Christ. It's because he was giving the gospel to the Gentiles. And because of that, he had been imprisoned. And all you need to do is read Acts. And you will see it very clearly. Of course, I've mentioned before, this is one of the prison epistles, along with Colossians, Philippians, and Ephesians. But when we say prison, he was captive in Rome. But he was a prisoner of the Lord's long before that, prisoner in that his heart was locked up in Jesus. Hey, that's the way I want to be locked up. Lock me up in a room with Jesus. You know, that's what happens when we pray. Okay, I'm back to that, aren't I? It's okay. I've got permission from my Father. But you see, when we lock ourselves up in a room and we go to that secret place and we lift it up to him, man, that's the best place to be. And it's hard to get there. Have you noticed that? It's hard to pray. Every time you go to pray, the phone rings, right? Or every time I go to pray, there's a knock at the door. Or every time I go to pray, and I don't know about you, but I'm like, did you guys ever see that cartoon movie Over the Fence? Was it Over the Hedge? Over the Hedge. Okay, what did the dog do all the time? He's in the middle of something. He goes, squirrel. That's me. So I have to close the windows and the blinds in my office, and there can't be any movement because that's the way I am. Squirrel, right? That's what happens to me even in prayer. I'll be there and a squirrel. So I'm kind of squirrely, I guess. But anyway, he says, I beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Here, Paul starts a new section of this book. See, the first three chapters of this book were focused on the graciousness of God, the riches that God has given us through his Son. It focuses on what God has done for us. Chapters 4 and 5 are going to focus on our response to God. Oh, did I say you needed to respond? Yeah, we need to respond to God. I mean, let's face it. If you think you worked for your salvation, you are sorely mistaken. God offered it. He initiated it. And by the way, even after you've given your life to the Lord, he initiates things in your heart and you respond to him. What's this initiation? He wants you to walk worthy of your calling. Well, what have we been called to? We've been called to be saints. I know it's hard to think of each other as saints because I know you guys. But in God's eyes, you are saints. In God's eyes, I'm a saint, Saint Michael. Okay, we've been called to be children of God. Children of God. Is that, you know, we throw that term around, but really think about that. Really think about being a child of God. Really think what a special privilege that is. To be a child of the living God who in his great wisdom made a way for us to be back in communion with him, with his only begotten Son who created the universe, who created everything. And anything that was, he created. And you're a child of his. Is that amazing? You know, we're not orphans. We're children of the living God. I love that. And so now I've been called to walk worthy of that calling. Okay, now there's where it gets tough. How many of you feel you're worthy? And if you are, put your hand down, because I don't want to know it. You need to talk to me afterwards. We don't feel like we're worthy. But you know what? The truth is, in God's eyes, he wants us to walk as though we are worthy of his calling. He called us to this. He called us to be heirs of salvation. Is that amazing? I think that's just really too much. It's overwhelming. And I'm not trying to lay a guilt trip. I'm saying that much too much today. But if you don't realize the riches that God has given to you, or if you just take them as just for granted, oh, brothers, sisters, we can't do that. We got to be thankful for it. We got to walk worthy. The way we respond to God is walking worthy of that calling. And how is that? I want to be like Jesus. I want to walk like Jesus walked. Am I doing it? Not yet. And probably won't while I'm here. But you know what? If you set your sights on walking any lower than walking as Jesus Christ, you're going to be in the cellar. Set your sights on walking like Jesus. Walk like Jesus. Is it difficult? Well, Jesus left us a helper, the Holy Spirit that dwells in every believer. And if you let the Holy Spirit talk to you, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us, because he left us that helper. You know what? What I'm saying is, you all have the tools. You have the tools. So, that's who we are in Christ. The epistle to the Ephesians, it's encompassing all the riches that God has for us, the way we're to walk. And then in chapter 6, which I taught a portion of that last week at the men's conference, it tells us that we're in a battle, and the only way we fight this spiritual battle is through prayer. See why that's important? Okay. So God's initiated this with us. By the way, I'm putting you on call. He has just initiated this. So our response is, let's walk. Let's walk worthy. Let's walk worthy. So let me just say this. In Ephesians 2:10, he tells us, for we are his workmanship. You see, we're not our own workmanship. And it always blows me away that you look on TV and you see some evangelist on TV that thinks it's all about him. It's not about him. It's about God. We are his workmanship. He's the one that gets the glory for anything we do that might be conceived as being good. And if we are successful to walk worthy of that calling, guess who gets the glory? God does. You know, that takes all the pressure off you. Just walk. He'll get the glory. You'll never get a puffed head out of it. There. So that's where we're at. But he says, for we are his workmanship, created in Jesus Christ for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, explanation there. Good works. Those good works don't get you saved. Those good works are a result of responding to God, because he has called you to walk this wonderful, worthy, righteous life. It's a response to God. Verse 2 says, here, this is how you're supposed to walk. This is where it gets interesting. Walk with all lowliness, gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love. So we are walking worthy of God's calling. Paul tells us it looks like this when we're doing it. Okay, with all lowliness. Now, it doesn't mean this. It doesn't mean we become somebody's doormat. That's not lowliness. But it means we have an attitude of humbleness. And that's what it means. It's a humble heart. It's not placing ourselves in a place that God needs to be. Remember, God hates the proud, but he exalts the humble. And not that you have a desire to be exalted, but we have a desire to please God. We have a desire to please God. That's where we need to be. Walk with all lowliness, walking in humility, having that humble attitude. Acts 20:19. Now, this is where Paul is talking to the elders from the church at Ephesus in a coastal city called Miletus. That's a great chapter to read. It gives you real insight that Paul knows that he's not going to be coming back that way. But he said in Acts 20:19, he says that he's serving the Lord with all humility, with many tears and trials, which happened to me by the plotting of the Jews. And when we say the Jews, we need to attach to that an adjective that says religious Jews, because that didn't mean everybody. That wasn't the whole nation. But he served with all humility. Now, when you read Acts and you see how Paul came to know the Lord, what Paul did from that time forward, you see one of the most humble servants. And it's interesting. God chooses the most unlikely. He chooses a prince in Egypt to lead his people out, Moses. And he actually says Moses was the most humble man that walked the face of the earth at that time. And you're thinking, wow, that's quite a compliment coming from God. But I think that Moses was humbled just in the presence of a mighty God. His experience with God on the mountain was humbling. Paul's experience on the road to Damascus, that was really humbling. You know why? Paul thought he had it all. You know, I went to the best schools. You know, I was raised by the best people. I'm Jew. I'm the privileged. We have salvation. And that's the way many Jews thought at that time. The religious Jews thought salvation was just for them alone. But we know, and God through Paul is telling the Ephesians, this is what I want you to understand. You Gentiles have this great gift. I'm so thankful. I'm a Gentile, and I have this great gift. Salvation. Salvation was for the world, but it was a mystery, and that's what God tells us, until it was revealed, and Paul was giving that to him. So with all lowliness, gentleness, oh my, I didn't mean to convict myself with all this, but here we go. You know, does Paul do that to you guys? Do you read it? Or is it just me? The Lord convicts when I read this. I'm not always gentle. You know what? Galatians 5:22-23 tells me what the fruit of the Spirit is. It says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering. There's that word again. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And I'm going, oy vey, man. That's some heavy duty stuff to fulfill. I shouldn't confess this, but I don't feel that. I know, and people, I don't mean you guys. You know me too well. We've got too much of a relationship. But there's some pastors that are kind of untouchable. You see them walk to the stage. You see them walk off, and you never see them other than that. You see me all the time. You see all the blemishes I have. If you get close enough, you see that I really am old. But I'm hanging in there. But you see me for who I am. Nothing's held back. I have made mistakes. I maybe have even made mistakes with you. And I hope if I have, you tell me so I can ask your forgiveness. But see, that's where it starts. We have to have a humble attitude. When I read this, I think, oh my gosh, I really don't measure up to this very well. I've got some work to do. Does anybody else feel that way? You don't have to raise your hands, but if you do, I'll really be proud of you. No, but you know what? This convicts my heart. It convicts my heart. I'm thinking, wow. Okay, there's that word. The next one is long-suffering. I've always been a fan of never putting those two words together. They don't fit in my vocabulary, but they happen to fit in God's vocabulary. And it is the Greek word for it is makrothymia, and it practically means it's forbearance. You know, you're forbearing somebody. Or simply, it's patience. Uh-oh, I understand that. It's patience. Now, when I'm describing myself, and maybe some of you are in this too, I don't know why it is, particularly fathers. Now, some fathers are quite patient, but fathers seem to be impatient. I got to encourage you men, and you young men who aren't fathers yet, but you will be patient. I made a lot of mistakes by not being patient. Patience is truly a virtue. And patience is something that God says that you do this, and that's how you walk worthy. Oh, man. If I had a frock, you could defrock me because I'm failing on all these. And if you were to be honest, you are too. These are difficult things to live up to. But remember, we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. That's what we need to remember. I can do this. Okay, I want you to say, we're going to get Pentecostal on everybody. Turn to each other and say, I can do this. Come on, let's get with the program. I can do this. I can do this. I'm only teasing about the Pentecostal thing. I'm kind of in the middle, and I can go Baptist, Pentecostal. It doesn't matter to me. I'm just a child of God. I believe the whole Bible. I don't pick and choose. But, you know, patience. It says bearing with one another in love. Now, I do want you to know something. That bearing is a sense of enduring patience. It's extended patience. We need to be patient through many, many trials. And once again, I want to tell you something, that I love all you guys. I love all you guys, and if I'm not patient with you, just remember I still love you. I hope you still love me. I came from a discipline working in accounting and finance my career, and we were disciplined. We just did this, and when something was awry, we freaked out. And we immediately went to find out what's going on, where the breakdown was, fix the breakdown, or fix the individual who broke it down, that type of thing. So when I get into work mode, you can ask Glenda, when I get into work mode, oh boy, Mike doesn't hear a thing you say. He just plows on through. So I apologize, but I've had 30-some years training in that, and it's going to be one that I need to break, but I want you to take something to the bank. When it says bearing one another in love, I'm working on bearing with everybody, and I want you to bear with me, because you see, you're stuck with me. You can't defrock me. I have no frock. But we've got love in this place. By the way, the word for love here is agape love. Now, there's a lot of different definitions, but the one that I really, really hold to the most is that agape love is an unconditional love. It's a godly love. And some people say, well, it's a high moral standard love. Now, that's the world's way of looking at it. Agape love, where Jesus uses it, it's a godly love. It's one that gives without requiring anything in return. See, you love somebody without this is agape love, that I love you, and you don't have to do anything to have the love of your pastor. I just do. That's agape love. There's four. There may be some more than four, but the four that are most commonly used in the Greek There's four different types of love commonly used, and they all mean something different, and they all mean love, where the English just has one word. Storge is one, and storge signifies a love, a family type of love, where a love for a parent to a child or vice versa. Then we have phileo, which means brotherly love or love friendship. And that's where the word Philadelphia, you've heard Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, what comes from initially the Greek word phileo. And of course, that only holds true in Philadelphia if you're an Eagles fan. If you're a Cowboys fan, no love. No love there. Where's the love, brother? No love there. So I guess I don't go to Philadelphia anymore. I grew up on the Cowboys. And then, of course, there's eros, and that's a sense of being in love or romantic love. And so, but agape is a special love. And when Jesus told Peter on the banks of Galilee after Peter had denied him, he said, Peter, do you agape me? Peter said, I phileo you. In other words, Jesus said, do you love me with that godly love? And Peter, probably really feeling low, he says, I really like you, Lord. And Jesus says, feed my sheep. And then he asked him again, Peter, do you love me? Peter said, I really like you, Lord. He says, then feed my sheep. Third time, Jesus says, do you like me, Peter? Peter says, I like you, Lord. But the point was made. He says, Peter, I love you. And he knows that Peter was going to be restored, and boy, howdy was he. He was restored. And I just find it really awesome. The Lord was so personal and real, and he's personal and real with us too. The Holy Spirit guides us into all righteousness if we let him. And guys, it's a matter of, hey, I can be long-suffering with the help of the Holy Spirit. I can bear you guys, and you can bear me with agape love, with the help of the Holy Spirit. Verse 3 says, it says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Boy, endeavoring. First of all, unity of the Spirit. You know, Satan wants to cause division. And by the way, Satan's been very effective at it. But he wants to cause division in the church. And you know what? He's done it. He's done a really good job, actually. And I hate to say this, but everybody kind of falls into this category. And we can disagree on some things, but it's like we all have done this, and we have to understand this. You see, he looks how he can put a division between us. But it says we're supposed to endeavor to keep this unity of spirit. Now, in the bond of peace, but endeavoring actually means you're working hard at it. You're working intensely at it to keep the unity of the Spirit. God said, he told his disciples, he said, they will know you by your love for one another. And I got to admit, you guys do a wonderful job of showing everybody that walks through that door, you not only are glad they're here and you will love them, but you love each other. I mean, occasionally we have spats like brothers and sisters. It's okay. We just need to make sure that then we get it worked out and we continue to walk worthy of our calling. Did you get that? I'm going to repeat that. Walk worthy of your calling. You're a child of God. Walk like you're a child of God. Okay, since we're having heart to heart here today, Endeavor means we do the best to work hard to keep the best we can do. And by the way, that doesn't mean you can slack off. Well, this is the best I can do. No, it's not. Keep working harder. You're lazy, right? Now you're going to go home and say, he said I was lazy. Well, we all kind of have that. But I'm going to admit something to you. Sometimes I look at some of the churches I see around us, and I think, well, I don't like the way they're doing things. They're not doing it the way we are. They're not doing it right. And, of course, let me put some clarification on that. I'm talking about somebody who is really the body of Christ. I'm not talking about somebody who is errant, totally errant. I'm talking about churches that are just down the street from us that do it differently. And you know, it's easy to get jealous. You see somebody's thriving, and instead of saying, wow, look, God's working there. God's working. How awesome is that? Sometimes we, and I'd include myself in this, because when you plant a church, man, sometimes it's hard. When there's four or five people on a Sunday morning, and, you know, we're not a huge church now, but you know what? We're big in here, and we're big in the Word. That's where we need to be deep. But as a small group, as this church grew, it was like, man, we see other people growing, and you think, what are they doing? And, oh, man, they've got the best worship money can buy, right? Isn't that what we say? And sometimes that is true. Sometimes that's absolutely true. But it's not true every time. We need to be careful what we say. I'm speaking to myself, but I want you to know it too. We need to be careful. We don't just throw a brother or a sister church under the bus because they're doing it a different way. I want to tell you why. Is this spiritual warfare? No, I'm teasing. Here's the reason why is that, you know what? We're reaching people they can't. And they're reaching people we can't. And we're the same body. We should be unified in spirit. And so it's like, well, we've got to be careful. You know why? Because God has given each body, each section of his body, Calvary Chapel of Forney, he's given us a uniqueness. And that uniqueness fits. It fits us right now, right? And it may not fit everybody, and that's okay. But the church down the street, what they're doing is unique, and they're getting people that we would never get. And but that's cool. That's the way that's the way it should be. We're unique, and that uniqueness enables us to reach somebody that someone else can't, and vice versa. Closing today, there is one body, one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. One body with different parts, yet the same. God doesn't look on the sign outside and say, oh, they're Presbyterians, or they're Foursquare, or they're Methodist, or they're Baptist. Well, maybe he does say that about Baptists. No, I'm kidding. He doesn't say that. I used to be a worship leader in a Baptist church. So, no, he doesn't say that about Baptists. I get sarcastic. But honestly, Jesus doesn't care what it says on the outside. He cares about what's going on in the inside. Not only applies to our church, but that applies to us. You know, we can make it look good, like, oh man, we're just awesome. But on the inside, we don't have the right thing going. So, you know, just want to encourage you. Endeavor to be one body, to be in unity. There's one body. You know what? Just as Jesus doesn't care about what the name on the outside. Did you know there's only one person that can say, it's my church, and that's Jesus Christ. He told Peter, he said, upon this rock I will build my church. But he's the only one that can say my church. And by the way, you can't join his church. You can't? No, you're born into it. You're born again into his church. The membership is to be born again. Born again. You're born into his church. That's really, I ripped that off of Pastor Chuck Smith, by the way, so I don't take credit for it. I'm trying to be humble here, but I loved that. I thought, oh, I got to share that, because that's true. We're born into the church of Jesus Christ. You're born again into his church. It's his church. We can say my church in the sense that, oh, that's where I go to church, but we can't say it's my church. It's his church. You know what? I just want to do what he's called me to do. And you just need to do what he's called you to do. And we need to walk, what is it? Worthy of our calling, right? Worthy of our calling. Your calling is, you're a child of God. Act like it. You're a child of God. Act like it. You know, it is true that in the body of Christ, when one person suffers, we all suffer. My example to that is also that when we see victory in one part of the church, we all should rejoice in that. The last year when I was in Vietnam, and you know, I brought the pictures and the video back of talking with those tribal pastors that are doing amazing work. And by the way, it's set. I'm going back January. And we're actually starting to teach up in Sapa. So, I got to get ready to go. And so I need your help. I need you to help me to figure out how to raise the funds. And then, so maybe we need garage sales, but we're going back. But to the point, those Vietnamese pastors, when you saw them worshiping. And I had the privilege of leading them in worship. And they were so stoked that John and I went there to just see them. And now we're training some of them up. We're training them up and giving them the much-needed doctrine that they need to understand their Bibles better. But, you know, they've stepped out on simple faith, and over 3,600 people in 7 years have come to faith in Jesus who were once polytheistic and paganistic worship, and they are coming to Christ. And you know what? For everybody who's a cessationist out there that says the gifts they were only for apostolic times, I beg to differ with you, because that is exactly how they're coming to the Lord, because they see there is no power in their gods, and they see the power of healing that God does in the people, and whole families and whole villages are coming to the Lord. And I mean, why do you think I'm so excited to go in there? Because when I see it working there, I rejoice. We rejoice. You guys rejoiced when you saw this. And we also, when we see a part of the body of Christ suffering, our hearts break. And we're along with it. We are one body, and that's the proof of it. That's the proof. One body, one spirit, one spirit. We understand there is one Holy Spirit, and that one Holy Spirit indwells every believer. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, no matter whether we sit here or down the road or up in Rockwall, no matter where we sit, we're brothers and sisters in Christ. We need to start acting like we are. I'll tell you why. Because you're going to have to spend a lot of time with each other eventually. It's one big family in heaven. You've heard about the story of the pastor who was talking to a gentleman who who hadn't been coming to church lately, and he asked the man, he said, "Hey, how come we don't see you much anymore?" And the man says, "Oh, well, to tell you the truth, I really don't like the people very much." Pastor said, he asked, he says, "Are you a born-again Christian, a follower of Jesus Christ?" The man said, "Yeah, I am." And he says, "Do you think that the people at our church are also born-again followers of Jesus Christ?" And the man said, "Yeah, I believe they are." Pastor said, "I think it would be a good idea for you to come back to church and get used to them now, because you're going to be spending a whole lot of time in heaven with them." And I think that's it. You know, that's also like the guy who said, "Well, I don't go to church because they're nothing but a bunch of hypocrites there." And the answer to that was, you better come to church and get used to them, because otherwise you'll be spending a lot of time with hypocrites. You know where that is, right? That's the other place. But that's what we need to do. We understand there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And I've got a story about baptism, but I can't tell it to you. It's a secret. No, it's not a secret. There's some churches that will only take their baptism. And Gwenda and I happened to be in a church like that, and it was the odd thing about it is that I was their worship leader. And we couldn't take communion because we weren't baptized in their church. So we talked to the pastor about it. I said, "Well, we have been baptized." And they said, "Yeah, but you haven't been baptized by us." We said, "Well, we don't understand." He goes, "Well, we believe that the local church needs to baptize." We said, "But we're in a universal church, one body, right?" And they said, "Well, we don't see it that way. We believe in the local church." And by the way, this is a man that we really loved, and we still do. And we just said, "Well, we don't understand." And he said, "Well, if you want to take communion, you have to be baptized. That's the denomination's rules." And we protested mildly by saying, "Well, what does that say about the Ethiopian eunuch that Philip witnessed to out of Isaiah?" Well, he was reading Isaiah 53, and Philip took him through it and showed him Christ in it. And he said, "Hey, there's water there. Is there any reason I can't get baptized?" He said, "No, not at all." So he got baptized. "Well, does that mean?" We asked the pastors, "It seems like the Bible's indicating that that was a good baptism, that he was obedient to being baptized." And he goes, "Yeah." And we said, "Well, the network?" And he goes, "I agree with you, but it's the denomination's rules." So it's like, whoa, you know? So these things really do happen. But there's one baptism, that's it. We baptize because Jesus said to be baptized. Jesus was baptized. He was our example. And what it is our baptism is the proclamation to people that I am his. It's a proclamation of something that's already happened in somebody's heart. They've been saved. And now they're doing this to tell the world, I am his. But there's one baptism. And I want to end with this, that all this reminds me of Amos 3:3. It says, "Can two walk together unless they're agreed?" And here's the problem. If the church is fractured, we're not in agreement. And I have to just say, how can we walk together unless we're in agreement? How can we walk together unless, how can we witness together? How can we be a good witness to the world if we're constantly fighting? Now, once again, I want to put the caution out there. That doesn't mean we're talking about a church that embraces totally aberrant doctrine. But we're talking about somebody who's truly a church of Christ, that we just maybe do things differently. There are times we have to call out, that's not right. But we can't do that to everything. We don't agree with the way they're practicing. We don't agree with the way they're running their church on Sunday or this or that. We have to look at it and say, are they believers in Jesus Christ? And let's not have disunity. Let's come together. That's what Paul is telling the Ephesians. And he's saying, you know what? There's one God, there's one body, there's one spirit, there's one baptism. Do you keep getting the same thing over and over again? There is one. There's one. That's it. So, I want to read you one more thing. Galatians 3:27-28 says, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ. Now, I've superimposed something on verse 28. We can say this. There is neither Baptist or Methodist. There is neither Calvary Chapel nor Church of Christ. There is neither Presbyterian nor Nazarene. For you are all one in Christ. We're all one in Christ. There's one God, there's one faith, and we need to just understand this. Now, I'm guilty of some of that. And so, like I said, this convicts my heart. And like, once again, just so I don't get any hate mail or email, is that I qualify that we're talking about those that are truly part of the body of Christ and not those that are aberrant in their doctrine. And I don't mean they have one little thing wrong. I mean they got the main things wrong. We're one in Christ. And if we think somebody's doing it wrong, pray for them. Pray for them. If we're doing something wrong, I want people to pray for us. Let's have unity. I think we have unity in this body. And let's look for that unity outside the church here and in other brothers and sisters. I'll tell you what, when I go to the conferences, every Calvary Chapel does things a little differently, but a lot of things they do the same. Hey, we're great with each other. I've been to other conferences where it was denominational. They were brothers and sisters. I guess my point is run into the ground at this point, but here's what I'm saying. Let's be one in Christ. Let's look for the opportunity to be one in Christ and be careful of how we criticize. Be careful of how we may get jealous. Be careful of all these things because we need to what? Walk worthy of our calling. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and we give you praise that, Lord, you have brought things like this to our attention that we might really understand how we can walk worthy. Lord, we struggle with a lot of the things we talk about today, and not to dwell on what we struggle, but each man, each woman can say, oh man, I need to work on that. I need to endeavor in that, work hard to overcome those things. So, Lord, help us by your Holy Spirit. I just ask that you would help us by your wonderful grace that you've given us. Show us grace in our learning, that we would really learn how to walk worthy of our calling. Our calling being, we're a child of the living God. And Lord, help us to learn how to walk that way. Thank you for Paul as he explains this to the Ephesians, and now we know. So, Lord, we lift this up to you and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand with me?
Hey, I'd also like to say that if there's anyone here who has not given their life to the Lord, we'd like to give you opportunity. We'd like to give you opportunity to accept Jesus. And if you're not sure, I'd love for you to come and talk to me about it afterwards. But if you know that the Lord's been leading you, you need Jesus, and you need to call out to him and say, Lord, I want you to be my Savior. I just say, even as we do this last song, to please do that. But then seek us out. Seek myself, Pastor Ray, or even those around you. And tell them that you have given your life to Jesus. And let us rejoice with you. We just want to offer that up to you. And we encourage you, don't let another day go by. Remember, the sign isn't up yet, but as you leave these doors, you're walking into the mission field. We got to remember that. Let's be a good testimony. And if anybody has any prayer needs, we'll be here to pray with you. Just bring them up, and we will pray. God bless you guys. Have a great week. come out tonight too.